ain't alright. The hardness of my head. Now close your eyes, spin around, say part time you could find, but ain't the way that you want. But it's still alright. Late at night, you lay around wondering, counting all the lines. It's so funny now, say times are hard to get this far, but it ain't the way that you want. I'll be damned if this old man don't start to count on his losses. But it's still alright.
Welcome back to another edition of the Great Lakes Divide podcast with Bluebelly Tom Crawford. I'm Ryan Schuling. The sounds you hear coming in, going out of GLD are brought to you by the Record Lounge in Rio Town. Heather Frari supplying us with all the music, and you can find it in her store. Don't go online. Don't make your shopping experience so impersonal and detached. Take a journey back through time like you used to. You go to the record store. You show up. New music every Friday. All the all-time greats as well. Hi-fi stereo equipment to play your records on. Vinyl, fresh pressed. Everything you could ask for in that store. It's in the Rio Town Marketplace. It's south on Washington from 496 downtown Lansing. If you're coming from Grand Rapids or Detroit or anywhere in between, very easy to find. Free parking on the street. And again, Heather Frari and her staff ready to serve you. If they don't have something you're looking for and it's very particular, it's very specific, maybe it's a gift idea, they can locate it, track it down, find it, order it, have it in store within 48 hours. That's how much they're dedicated to customer service. And you can find them on Facebook, like them there, follow them on Twitter. That's the Record Lounge in Rio Town. Big news on Tuesday, obviously, Mark Dantonio stepping down after 13 seasons at Michigan State. I don't know that this was altogether unexpected. In fact, tip of the cap to my partner in crime, Bluebelly Tom Crawford, who I think basically predicted this as the offseason began. It was just a matter of when, how, and perhaps why. And we may never know why exactly. What we do know, President Stanley, Athletic Director Bill Beekman, Board of Trustees, all gave their full vote of confidence to Mark Dantonio, which makes this Dan Bernstein report from 670 The Score in Chicago all the more puzzling. He says in a tweet, quote, sources confirmed to 670 that Mark Dantonio was forced out by Michigan State, chose the option to step down instead of being fired. Latest allegations, merely the final straw. Now, those allegations were outlined in a deposition that he gave over 7 hours to attorneys for Curtis Blackwell, former Michigan State employee and coach, and somebody that had become intertwined with the program based on his recruiting ties to the city of Detroit, and that led MSU football down a primrose path, away from the typical type of recruits that Mark Dantonio had. You can talk about Jack Conklin, you can talk about Darquez Denard, Le'Veon Bell, guys that come in that were unheralded, that turned into stars because they were coached up. Now, because Michigan State had made it to the Rose Bowl and won, gotten to the Cotton Bowl and defeated Baylor, made it to the college football playoff and got that national profile against Alabama, it was a blessing and it was a curse. Because now 4- and 5-star recruits were interested in Michigan State, the types of players that Urban Meyer would get at Florida. You know where that goes. Aaron Hernandez is the worst example of that. Ohio State, Nick Saban at Alabama. These are now the types of recruits, the waters that Michigan State began to wade in, and there were sharks. And little did they know what kind of trouble that would bring down upon the program in the form of Corley King and Vance, an entire episode, and how that was handled or not handled by Blackwell himself, him being led out of the Duffy Doherty building in handcuffs, intel that I got firsthand when it happened, and a lot of people came after me, gave me a lot of heat on Twitter and on my radio show at the time in Lansing. That didn't happen. It did happen. It did happen, and I know it happened because I had a source that saw it firsthand, that watched it happen, Rico Beard, a colleague of mine and Tom Crawford as well, is close associated with Curtis Blackwell. And when he heard my report, said, I don't know about that, and decided to reach out to Blackwell and ask him, hey, you know, this guy, me, said you were let out of Doherty in handcuffs and arrested. Is that true? And Curtis Blackwell confirmed that to Rico. Yes, that was true. That did happen. Now, of course, Blackwell had severe reservations about how that was handled and, you know, whether it was for show or if they overreacted. You know, they were trying to get access to his phone records, text messages, exchanges between him, the three players that I mentioned, Corley King and Vance, perhaps parents of theirs. And how is that very volatile situation in real time handled with all the sensitive implications involved, including Title IX, including the background and backdrop of Larry Nassar and everything that was going on, the shitstorm that Michigan State found themselves in, and now this too. Mark Dantonio had Austin Robertson come into his office and tell him about this incident involving Corley King and Vance. He was a whistleblower, in a sense. Dantonio, by all accounts that I know, through law enforcement, administration, etc., at that moment, shut it down, turned it over to authorities. He personally handled that the right way. What backfired on Dantonio that perhaps inflicted even more damage to his prestige, his reputation, his status, not only in the community in East Lansing, Michigan State, statewide, nationally, was that very whistleblower, Austin Robertson, was then caught in a sexual assault accusation of his own. He is currently serving time in the Upper Peninsula up at Baraga. And this all came crashing down on Dantonio in successive fashion. The spring game, you know, they didn't pass out a roster because they didn't want it to get out which players were involved. We were all playing a guessing game up in the press box at Spartan Stadium. I mean, this was all so surreal and bizarre as it happened once again and unfolded in real time. Mark Dantonio dodged all these bullets and made it through. But the problem not only was the off-field stuff, but the coaching staff that he refused to address. He was stubborn and stalwart and doubling down, tripling down on his guys, his coaching staff, Dave Warner, Brad Salem, Jim Bowman on down on the offense. Tressel by himself, once Harlan Barnett left, they had been co-defensive coordinators. The program has regressed since that college football playoff appearance in that game, which they lost bigly to Alabama. From that point forward, until Mark Dantonio stepped down on Tuesday, Michigan State was 27-25 overall. 27 wins, 25 losses. The epitome of mediocrity on the field and these off-the-field problems and the deposition. Now, Mark Dantonio disputed whether or not the deposition, the allegations most recently reported by Tony Paul on Tuesday in the Detroit News, that there may have been recruiting violations alleged once again by Curtis Blackwell. The timing of this is interesting to me. Mark Dantonio does not resign, retire, whatever, at the end of the regular season, which was another not so great regular season. Doesn't step away after the bowl win over Wake Forest. Stays around to collect a $4.3 million bonus on January 15th. He's still there. There's no indication that he's leaving. And here we are going all the way up to February 4th, where today, as we record this podcast, Tom and I, it is Wednesday, February 5th. That is National Signing Day. Now, the second wave of these, as college football is set up now. And I just ask you to step away if you're a Michigan State fan, or if you're a Michigan fan, put aside your bias as much as you can and ask yourself, is this usual? Is this normal for a head coach of a major Division I Power 5 football program to step away the day before signing day, the day when a report from the Detroit News comes out that there are potential recruiting violations? I'm just asking about the timing here. If he knew he was going to step down, now I don't begrudge him necessarily collecting that $4.3 million bonus and staying on until then. But by all accounts within the building administratively, whether it's Stanley or Beekman or the Board of Trustees, this hit everybody like a ton of bricks, blindsided. They didn't see it coming. They didn't know it was coming. Mark Dantonio had not shared this decision with them. And so I asked the follow-up, if he is truly making this decision in the best interest of the football program first and his legacy in that regard, why not, when the regular season's done, have a very private conversation? Could be with Beekman and Stanley only. Maybe you pull in a Board of Trustee member or two, possibly. And you say, look, I want an exit ramp. I want to get out. I want to wait. You know, I think I'm entitled to the bonus. I think that's fair. I'll even concede that point. But we need to have a smooth transition here to hit the ground running so we don't lose in recruiting, so we have the right guy lined up. If that's Luke Fickell or Harlan Barnett or anybody else, Pat Narduzzi, go on down the list. We need to make sure, and I want to make sure, that this is not about me. It's not a personal, selfish decision about when it's best for me to step away, but what is in the best interest of Michigan State football. And I can tell you this, him dropping a bombshell on February 4th, unbeknownst to anyone outside his immediate circle and family, even his team, his staff, the administration, fans, alumni, donors, season ticket holders, that was not kosher. That was not cool. Now, I don't know, again, any of the details and the inner workings of this, but it certainly seems like Michigan State has been caught with their pants down. They have no alternative right now. They may lose a slew of recruits in today's announcements. And who could blame them if Mark Dantonio came into your living room and said, I'm going to be here. I'm going to be like a father figure. We got a coaching staff in place. We've got the facilities. We've got the infrastructure. Your son is going to be taken care of by me. And oh, by the way, day before your son commits and signs that national letter of intent, I'm out of here. It doesn't add up. It just doesn't add up. If you're intellectually honest about it and assessing the situation, it stinks on its face, on the surface. Now, getting to some commentary from Mark Dantonio, he had a rather terse exchange with one Dan Murphy, and they have a past. I've been there before. Dan Murphy, ESPN, had reported on some of the Nassar stuff, the Austin Robertson situation, Corley King and Vance. He was not a favorite of Mark Dantonio's. I was at a press conference where Dan Murphy asked a question, and Coach Dantonio might have given him two or three words of an answer. I asked the next question. He gave about a paragraph. You can deduct from that what you will. But this was the exchange when Dan Murphy asked whether or not the allegations made by Curtis Blackwell, reported in the Detroit News on Tuesday, had anything to do with his decision to step aside. He was quite defensive about this particular point.
I guess call it difficult timing, being February 4th in terms of finding your successor. And will you have any role whatsoever in helping?
Are you kidding me? People will run to here. They'll crawl here. Michigan State will get an outstanding football coach that will care about young people. They have a great foundation coming back. This program has won a lot more than it's lost. As indicated by 13 years and what has happened here. They're on the threshold of building new facilities. There are so many things happening here. So someone who has the opportunity to come here, have a fresh start and a vision for 3 to 5 years. And my goal, and my goal for anybody who's choosing the coach, and I may be involved a little bit, may not, but is that they hire somebody who will be here 13 or 14 years and win 114-plus games. My vision for this program is for this program to move forward in a big way. You can take a step back right now, and you can recognize what this place has become in 13 years, where it's at and what it's become, and you can push that forward and elevate this program even further. And I believe that that can happen.
So D'Antonio's claim is no, that had nothing to do with his decision. That's what he's saying publicly. Justin Rose, Cracklin' Rosie, as I call him, from WXYZ, Channel 7 in Detroit, asked Coach Dantonio, well, the question that I have posted on my Twitter right now that you can follow along, at Ryan Schuling, that's RyanSchuling, about whether or not Coach Dantonio has left the Michigan State football program better than when he found it when he took the baton from John L. Smith. I've got my thoughts on that, which I'll share in a moment, and we'll get Tom's as well. I just want to set the whole table for this conversation. Here was Coach D'Antonio's response to Justin Rose.
Well, I think that's pretty safe to say. I really haven't looked back too much. I haven't had a chance. My job, I'm telling you, my job and all these coaches' jobs who operate at this level is 24/7. You play a game, you get a chance to watch it once, evaluate it, and you move on. You never take the opportunity to rewatch it and say, hey, I wonder what the Rose Bowl was like. I've never watched the Rose Bowl. I watched the Rose Bowl one time. You don't have a chance to do those type of things, to reflect. You have a chance to see your young people and reflect with them a little bit. And when guys come back, Kari Willis came back this week. But you have very, very little time for yourself to be able to reflect on the things that you've been able to accomplish because you're always trying to move forward. And that's what we've tried to do here, and that's what I've tried to do, and I've tried to keep it like this. At Michigan State, from the first day I walked in this place, I've said many, many times, if we can just go like this, you can be extremely successful. And I said that on the first day that I walked in here, and I'll say it on the last.
And that's what he said, head coach Mark D'Antonio, as we bring Tom Crawford now into the conversation. The story once again, Mark D'Antonio retiring after 13 seasons at Michigan State, many of them very successful. But if we're going to answer the question again, honestly, directly, fairly, about how he leaves this football program in the wake of 27-25 over his last 52 games, that's no arbitrary slice now. That's going back over three full seasons and the playoff game. They're a mediocre, middle-of-the-road Big Ten team, to be kind. And if you look at the upcoming schedule, I challenge you to find six wins on that schedule for next year's Spartans. So if you're going to ask me, had Mark D'Antonio, you know, rode off into the sunset following the playoff loss to Alabama, had he left the program in better shape than when he found it, the answer would be an obvious yes. But that's not when he left. He is leaving in the wake of a very down cycle in his recruiting, in their coaching, in their personnel across the board, in their performance on the field. And you could argue there's a saying, two of them that come back, I think, to haunt Mark D'Antonio and his legacy. One is obvious, pride comes before the fall. Wow. The other one is he likes to complete circles. I would argue that, unfortunately, while there was tremendous success and much of it unprecedented, and only was it equaled by Duffy Doherty in the mid-60s in terms of national profile and accomplishment achievement, winning the Rose Bowl over Stanford, done. Winning the Cotton Bowl against Baylor in come-from-behind fashion, tremendous. Getting to the college football playoff, something Michigan has not done. His arch rival down the road, he got there, he did that, he won the Big Ten title against Iowa that year and got to the semifinal. Can't take any of that away from him. But when you go 3-9 after that, when you have break-even campaigns, basically, that are only broken up by a 10-win Holiday Bowl victory against Washington State in San Diego, and then you leave, you've basically completed the circle back, regressing to where this program was when he found it with John L. Smith. So my argument to that question would be he left it exactly how he found it. It's not worse, but you cannot argue, I don't think sanely, rationally, convincingly right now, to me or anybody else that follows this program, that he has left this program as of right now, February 5, 2020, in better shape than when he found it. It's not in better shape than 4 years ago. It's in worse shape than then. So there's this arc that you can follow. I don't think it's that, you know, complicated to analyze here, where he took the program over. It was not great. He built it up to great heights. That happened. But you have to acknowledge what happened these last 3 years. And this team has not been good. And this program has not been good. And I'm talking just on the field, let alone these off-the-field distractions and missteps. Bring in Blue Billy Tom Crawford. So, Tom, after all this, you hear the announcement yesterday. One, I can't believe you were surprised, because we've been kind of vacillating on this topic ever since the season ended, whether you thought Mark D'Antonio would even be the head coach at Michigan State come 2020. It turns out that will not be the case. You basically predicted it. What came true to fruition as you heard this story break, and what still maybe doesn't add up for you?
Well, February 4th doesn't add up. The fact that seven of his recruits were early enrollees, they're on campus, mind you. They have committed where they're going to school here, giving up their senior year in high school to start with this new program, this new venture in their lives under Mark Dantonio, and he bolts on them 3 weeks later. Are you kidding me? Back to your first question, this is a classic bell curve, I think. You know, I agree with you. It kind of is the way he's leaving it as he got it. But I take that back. It's worse. It's totally worse. You have cavernous gaps. You have sections in that stadium that are empty. You have an offense that's pathetic. You have a program that's under investigation. He's under a six-hour deposition. John L. Smith never went through any of that stuff. He just, you know, had rants on the sidelines about the coaches are screwing it up. I mean, this is – I'm really saddened that he's leaving because I like where it was headed, downhill. That's what I want Michigan State, to go downhill, and he was taking it downhill, and he got slapped around the park 44-10 to Jim Harbaugh. He had a losing record against Jim Harbaugh, who sucks as a coach, according to Michigan State fans. Boy, he must suck. I don't like Mark Dantonio. I never have. I think he drips of hypocrisy. He is a hypocrite. My God, you're talking about what's best for the school or the program, things like that, and you're grabbing your $4.3 million, and 20 days later, and then you're going out the door because you've talked it over your family, and you're talking about this avalanche or whatever that's coming down. Every coach goes through that. You knew that going into this. How many years have you been coaching? He left the timing of it. Is deplorable. I don't understand it. And I don't understand Michigan State retaining him. And is that some kind of contractual thing in the athletic department? What the hell is he going to do? Which also confuses me, because if there is indeed something coming down here, like we think about with this Curtis Blackwell situation, where there's potential, you know, there's accusation of commitment of NCAA violations, if that's looming, why would you retain him? There's so many things that are contradicting in this, Ryan. I can't figure out, but the timing is horrible.
There's so much I want to unpack with what you just said, Tom, and I agree with all of it. All of it. I don't dispute any of it. But I know you had a negative opinion of Coach Dantonio going into yesterday. With how this was handled, the timing with which it was done, does this confirm what you already knew about Coach Dantonio, or does this even lower his profile and your opinion of him?
Well, it lowers it. You know, and I was so pissed off at BTN yesterday paying homage. And, you know, it's an ass-kissing local schmokel network. But I watch it, you know. But I less watch it because it kisses D'Antonio's ass way too much. I went Mike Hall and Dave Resnick, are you kidding me? They were making him the second coming of Bear Bryant. And that whole thing about a little brother and all that stuff and, you know, when is enough and all that stuff. And we're just getting started and pride comes before the fall. That bullshit started with him on Labor Day weekend after the Appalachian State game. He had the first shot over the bow, if you will. It was him that started it. BTN makes very little reference to that, and it freaking pisses me off. And Mike Hart makes stupid comments, but D'Antonio started that shit, and that's why I have little respect for him.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair to Tom's point about Appalachian State, I think Coach Dantonio found out about the fact that Appalachian State in 07 had beaten Michigan in one of the greatest upsets in college football history, and it was during his pregame show, if I'm not mistaken, and he retorted at that time, let's have a moment of silence, right? Am I right, Tom?
Oh, it was Tony. You had to hear this. I mean, yeah, absolutely. It was just his snarky little way about him. He's in Ohio, you know, he did the Ohio State stint. He hates Michigan. I understand that. He's from Ohio. I understand that. He hates Michigan. But I'm telling you what, man, I thought the fact that that's so downplayed, that first shot, the reason they were out there in the middle of the field after that 07 game was because they were pissed off at his comments. They were kneeling down for a moment of silence because it was mocking. The mocking started with that clown, not the Michigan football team.
Tom's fired up. I could definitely tell. Here's the thing, too, Tom, about the timing. And again, if I'm going to set aside the $4.3 million, which I have a hard time doing because that's a good 1 year's worth of salary for a head football coach that they might hire.
No kid. No kidding.
Whether that's Luke Fickle or Pat Narduzzi or Matt Campbell, or go on down the list, whoever you'd like to target, that's money that could have been spent on a head coach that they don't have that's in D'Antonio's pocket. Fine, whatever. But again, for Beekman and Stanley and the Board of Trustees to go, I had no idea. I didn't know this was coming. How incompetent is the leadership at Michigan State? I'm being fully serious right now. Where you didn't see this coming. You didn't anticipate it. You didn't plan for it. You didn't have contingencies in place. You didn't pull Coach D'Antonio aside. Hey, look, is there any chance, you know, we got this deposition coming up? They knew about that, that we might. I mean, we're not going to forfeit your $4.3 million. We're still going to deliver on that. But we got to know if you're going to leave us in the lurch here, Coach D'Antonio, which is what he is doing, that we got to have a plan. We got to have a path forward, and we'd like you to help us with that. Can you give us a heads up, and we'll do some back channel searching for the next head coach? And what's going to tell me exactly what the administration knew or did not know, Tom, is the timeline of this next hire. Now, is it going to be rushed? Are they just going to elevate Tressel from within? Are they going to pluck Harlan Barnett over, who's just lost his job at Florida State? Can they talk Pat Narduzzi into coming back from Pitt? Is it going to be an insider candidate like that? If it is, it tells me they were totally, again, pants down around their ankles. And secondly, if they don't do a full national search, if they don't go full bore after a guy like Luke Fickle, who's a hot name out there that they could bring into the Big Ten the same way they brought D'Antonio from the same school, University of Cincinnati, then that tells me they had absolutely no groundwork, no preparation, no anticipation. You know, they're just absolutely rudderless in leadership from the top on down at Michigan State. And it's even worse than I thought, Tom. And you know, I thought it was pretty bad.
Well, this is where the same old Sparty stuff comes in, you know. I mean, because they're going back to same old Sparty. And it reminds me of when Dale Rogers left back in 1979. And I think they were kind of tinkering the idea, can we go get George Prolis? They ended up hiring Muddy Waters. Okay, this has a Muddy Waters hire looming all over it the way this. But February 5th, I mean, who are you going to get? I mean, today or in the past few weeks, I mean, Luke Fickle has just inked one of the best recruiting classes University of Cincinnati has ever had, and he's dominating a conference. Now, he might come up here, and I'm telling you what, you talk about stoking a rivalry. Harbaugh and Luke Fickle, they don't like each other. This could be great, and it could be great for the Great Lakes Divide, man. It could be a home run hit, but can they do that? And my guy, when you think if that happens, think about the University of Cincinnati. Their coach bolts on him on signing day or thereafter. And the other thing is, you know, I know Glenn Tsukiyami, who's a friend of mine he's got this research firm in Chicago, and evidently he's been hired to look for a coach. Where are you going to find him? Where are you going to find a coach that's already now locked into their program? The timing is absolutely crazy. And the fact that coaches didn't even know until yesterday, you know, sometime yesterday, that he told the team, some coaches didn't. I mean, this is unfreaking believable. And what was last night? Did he give a little speech at halftime? Did you see that? How long that lasts? Like 15 seconds?
Yeah, let's get to that right now for the basketball game, and we'll get to that contest in and of itself in a moment. But here is Mark D'Antonio addressing the assembled crowd at Breslin Student Events Center. Very brief in his comments.
Thank you so much. Big day today, emotional day today, but make it through. I want to thank all of you. I want to thank all of our former players and our coaches and administrators. You have truly made this a dream come true for the D'Antonio family. So thank you so much. I'll be a Spartan forever. Go Green, beat Penn State.
Another thing I noticed, Tom, was there and then in the press conference clips we've played, his voice sounded halted and weaker and not the same kind of Mark D'Antonio I remember covering in the press conferences, being firmly in control, you know, stoic in his delivery.
I agree totally. Yes.
Yeah. He sounded almost broken, like it was very much a guy that had been defeated and was walking away. But to the point, once again, that the Stan Bernstein report out of 670, The Score in Chicago, says that he was forced out. He was given the option to either retire or be fired. I have to call bullshit on that. Who in the administration, first of all, they claim they don't know, and I take them at their word. President Stanley, Bill Beekman, Brian Masalim or Joel Ferguson or anybody on the board, any big-time donor like Pete Secchia, I can't think of a single person that would have walked up to Mark Dantonio and go, look, either you retire or resign, or we're firing you. I just don't think that was possible. I don't think it happened.
No. God, I hesitate to go politics here, but it's a little bit like Donald Trump with the Republican Senate. I mean, you just have this core base that's not going to question anything, and then you have in the Michigan State fan base, you have a Dantonio base that think he can still walk on water. He's got a very, very interesting legacy at Michigan State, but the thing of it is that legacy. If there is a probe going on of some sort, this Curtis Blackwell thing is not going to go away just because Dantonio resigned. Yeah, if you think that's going to end, that's going to linger. It's going to be interesting to see what comes out of that because his legacy could be botched up a little bit, to say the least.
That's well said, Tom. This story is still being written. It is TBD, to be determined, on whatever the fallout of this is, if there is any, for Michigan State football. If they are hit with sanctions, if they are hit with scholarship reductions, if they are hit with a bowl ban or any kind of probationary period. I mean, if you look at the full picture of Mark Dantonio, again, fairly, you have to take into account all the great accomplishments and achievements. Those cannot be taken away from him. That kind of wheelhouse era between the Rose Bowl victory and the playoff appearance. Boom. And in between, what they were able to accomplish and do, the Big Ten championships, all of that. That's part of it. But equally part of it is Corley King and Vance and Austin Robertson and the decisions made in recruiting, basically the deal with the devil that you made, that you're going to bring these guys, questionable character in Robertson's case specifically, onto campus and roll those dice of your legacy and take that chance and make that bet and make that gamble. Why? I'll never figure that out. I know you want to win. But in order to kind of build the type of foundation, the character of a football program that he was striving for, I don't think you take chances on a guy like that. Now, by many accounts, Corley King and Vance, you know, those guys were also recruited by other schools like Michigan, Notre Dame. Other schools on Robertson, though, they were out. And that, I think, was the tipping point in Mark Dantonio's legacy. It's a mixed bag. It's a lot of good. It's some considerable bad. And maybe some in-between mediocrity over these last couple of years. That's his legacy. And it's better than a lot of other coaches in the past for Michigan State. I wouldn't put him necessarily above Duffy Doherty in his cultural impact and winning national championships and integrating college football, everything that Duffy did. Short of Duffy, you've got Biggie Munn before him. You got George Perlis. I think Dantonio exceeded, obviously, what George Perlis did. Nick Saban didn't stick around long enough to make any kind of legacy at Michigan State. Certainly, he's better than the clowns that followed and Bobby Williams and John L. Smith. So you just have to view it in its proper context and perspective here. There's just so many people. Now, I know you come at it from an angle, and Michigan fans would, too, about, you know, you hate Dantonio and the things that he said, and he stoked the rivalry, and he kind of played both sides of the fence in that and played the victim and whatever. But then there's the pro-Dantonio crowd, of which I'm not entirely a part of either. You know, I'll sing his praises, and I thank him for his service and what he did for the school, and there's a lot of good that came with that. But I'm not in the tank and a honk for him to say that all his sins should be washed away and overlooked, because that's not right. That's not intellectually honest, Tom.
No, it's not. And you know, I still go back to the way he's left the program. He's sitting up there like, you know, just, you know, throwing his chest out like he's leaving his program in a better situation than it was. And then to the point that he's saying that anybody will crawl, mind you, to come and coach Michigan State. Are you freaking kidding me? The Des Moines Register set that record straight on Matt Campbell. He has no interest in coming to Michigan State. Iowa State, Ames, Iowa, not coming to East Lansing. Who wants to come to Michigan State right now? You got no freaking quarterback. Your recruiting class is totally a train wreck. You're competing against the Ohio State University. I mean, one of the best programs in history, in my mind, in terms of sheer personnel coming in on a consistent basis for the last 15 to 20 years. Ohio State is unprecedented. And then you have Michigan. Yeah, underachieving, yeah. But they're, you know what? They got better talent than you, and they beat your ass the last 2 years, okay? And it's going to continue. So I don't understand how he can say authoritatively that he's leaving this thing in such great standing. The whole thing yesterday, I thought, and then you had the media, which I don't think really through, I don't know, compelling questions to get him to respond. I didn't hear it all because I was down in Ann Arbor for the Michigan Ohio State basketball game that we'll talk about shortly. But I just I'm baffled by this whole thing on so many levels.
And we'll keep an eye on this, obviously, going forward as the coaching search now ensues for Michigan State. And where does it go? And how quickly is it resolved? It will reveal a lot about the now remaining leadership at Michigan State. And this is, unfortunately, the bargain that you make when you're all in and you push your chips to the middle of the pile on Mark Dantonio and he bails at this time, right before National Signing Day. You get what you pay for, Michigan State. You get what you pay for. And now they look to be completely upended, uprooted, disheveled, and completely ill-prepared. That's the read I've got on it. We'll see if I'm wrong, but I don't think that I am. With Bluebelly Tom Crawford, I'm Ryan Schuling. This is the Great Lakes Divide podcast. It's brought to you in part, entirely, in fact, by the Record Lounge in Rio Town. A great music supply. You won't find it anywhere else. All the vinyl you could dream of, both present-day music that comes out each and every Friday, including new releases this Friday, and all the all-time classics as well. Classic rock, funk, soul, R&B, rap, all the way down the list. You can find it at the Record Lounge, and Heather Ferrari will locate it for you. If she doesn't have it in stock, in store, she's got connections throughout the whole state of Michigan that she'll work those connections, order it for you, get it in store within 48 hours, and there you go. You pick it right up. Take a journey back through time. Take a look ahead at the future of music with the Record Lounge in Rio Town. We'll stick with Michigan State on the hard court and the Spartans falling at home to Penn State. There's no shame in this loss. As I watched this game, this isn't like the Wisconsin game where I'm like, well, Michigan State lost it, Wisconsin didn't win it. This was the Nittany Lions. They were no joke. They came to play. Lamar Stevens scores 24 points on 9 of 20 shooting. Shag, 7 rebounds. He is ably assisted by Myron Jones, who was just a revelation from 3, 6 of 8 from distance, just daggers one after the other. Every time Michigan State looked like they were going to make a move or maybe get back in this game, and they were trailing for a good portion of it because of the distance provided by the three-point shooting of Jones, he would throw another one in. He had 20 points to go with 5 assists. MSU falls in this one 75-70. They get 25 out of Cassius Winston, not one of his better shooting nights by any means. He was 3 of 11 from 3, including a critical missed free throw, the only one he would miss in the game, with an opportunity to tie it late, clang off the back of the rim. Coach Izzo calls timeout, draws up a play for him, a pretty good one. Got him a look as Winston inbounded to Tillman, got it back, and had an off-balance three from the top of the key, a very similar shot he hit earlier in the game. Missed it. Michigan State falls short by 5. Not a single other player for Michigan State was in double-digit scoring, and that was one of the death knells of this game. Tillman only had 9 points, did have 11 rebounds, did have 5 block shots, committed 5 fouls, but again, full effort game from him in 36 minutes. Nobody else took the mantle, though. Nobody else scored more than 7. Gabe Brown had that many. Aaron Henry just 6. He looked good for a couple of flashes, but his typical kind of disappearing act self in this game only takes 6 shots, makes 3 of those for 6 points, turns the ball over 4 times, and that was a big factor in this game. Unforced errors by the Spartans, just giving the ball away, handing it off, careless with the basketball, mindless with the basketball. And points into turnovers by Penn State, a big factor in this game. MSU ends up with 15 turnovers, Penn State just 9. Rebounding margin, again, not what MSU needs. It was slight. They need a big rebounding margin, just 36-34 in this game. Michigan State shot well from 2, but not from 3. 7 of 23 for the contest, just 30% on the night. Tom Izzo had his thoughts after this game, and they quickly turned to criticism of his players. You can hear it here.
But I'm going to tell you something, guys, and I really mean this from the bottom of my heart. If there's any Michigan State people out there that are abusing some of my players on that frickin' Twitter, I'm sick of it. okay? I'm sick of dealing with what I got to deal with and that. So if they are Michigan State fans, I'd be more than happy to buy their tickets. And I mean that. I mean that. Now, if they're not, but some of the stuff that my guys have put in front of me the last couple of days, I mean, we're still 16-7. We're not 5-20. I'm pretty proud of this place. I'm pretty proud of the 550,000 living alums. And it's despicable on some of the things that have gone out there about some of our guys that have given more to this program than most of those alums or most of those people sitting behind a chicken keyboard. So we're going to show up. We're going to show up to answer the question. We're going to practice harder. We're going to be harder on them. We can't be too hard on them now. Let's be real about this. We got to make sure we balance everything. And I'm going to balance it the best I can balance it. But we can't keep turning the ball over. And if that doesn't change, I'm going to just have to make sure it does change, because there's no question that that has cost us some games. And this was one of the worst when you look at the points off of turnovers. But I'm asking all Michigan State fans, real fans, to understand. I get paid a lot of money, so take your shots at me. But don't take them on a kid who's been a 3-7 student who's done more for this university than most of those people have. I just, it's despicable to me. So that's my shout out to my either people that love me or people that hate me.
Okay, Tom, I want to get your thoughts on that. I'm trying to figure out 3.7 student. It's given more to this university than anybody that's criticizing him, who he's referring to. I can't imagine it's Cassius Winston. I think it might be Xavier Tillman. Xavier's had some, you know, difficulties of late. And I went back, Tom. I did. I mean, I'm looking at things, you know, things that I say on Twitter. And I am critical at times. It's never personal. It's always performance related. I try to keep it fair. He missed several point blank bunny chances. I also looked at the Twitter accounts of some mainstays who I follow and who follow me that are Michigan State fans. I don't know that I saw anything that rose to the level of the response that Tom Izzo had. If he is just kind of building a bunker mentality and insulating his guys and maybe taking some slings and arrows so that Xavier Tillman doesn't have to, that could be a coaching psychological move there, and I would understand that. But I don't know what he's referring to in terms of unfair comments that were personal, and there may have been some. I'm not ruling that out, but they're usually from a lunatic fringe, people that don't matter. And if people are upset and they're emotionally invested in Michigan State and they've lost these games, this is a team that was ranked number one to start the season. With that comes great expectations. With great expectations come great responsibility. And, you know, you're going to have some setbacks here in a 16-7 season that people aren't going to be happy with. And I don't know that it's a bad thing necessarily that they're expressing their frustration with Xavier Tillman missing some close-up shots. It's not that they're saying that he's a bad person or a bad father or a bad husband or a bad student or anything like that. What to you is fair game for a fan watching a game who's watching it in real time, and Twitter's part of reality now in how they conduct themselves and what they say about players?
Well, let me start this. First of all, I posted, you know, I saw that video on YouTube. I posted it, made comments of it, because Tom Izzo is awesome in my mind. I mean, he coaches a school that I can't stand, but I just admire him so much, both on a personal level and just from afar. I think he's saying a message that this world needs to hear in this really contentious, put the other person down mentality. I do know this: whenever someone makes a post like that, they typically delete it within a half hour to an hour if it's really bad. So going back and researching that is kind of trying to find a needle in a haystack. Most of the time, it's been deleted. I know a person that after Michigan State lost a football game, I'm trying to think of which one it was, late in the season, says, "Oh, the whole team." And this guy was a public official. The whole team should be called, taken out in front of the stadium and shot. I mean, this is the kind of crap that people, Michigan State alumni and a public official, will say. I'm not going to name the name, but this is the kind of the crap that he's referring to. What does surprise me, though, Ryan, was that I do remember at the start of the year, I thought that Twitter was supposed to be off limits for his players. And so I don't know if a player brought this to him. I do know this. He told me a few years ago a player showed a tweet to him, and the player was in tears because it was a really personal dig at this player's family. I mean, it's the root of all evil is the internet and social media that's written in ink.
Yeah, the one that you're talking about, I know that there was something involving, I believe, Nick Ward and Nick Ward's mom at one point with, again, there's random fans that are not representative of the whole cloth fabric of Michigan State fans out there who are largely and almost entirely supportive of Michigan State come hell or high water, win or lose. And that's what I see. And those are the people I engage with. And if I see somebody who's off the deep end, I don't follow them. I block them or I mute them or whatever else. And again, I'm honestly trying to look at this and say, you know, are there things that are going on where it's across a line? And the majority, the vast majority, I say, is not. Now, if Xavier Tillman goes 3-15 and fans have, you know, they're upset by that or they think, you know, I don't know that anybody was questioning his effort. If that happened, if they question his effort or his commitment or his dedication or him as a human on some level, then, yeah, I'm with Tom Izzo on that. 100%. But I got to be very sincere and direct and say, I haven't noticed that type of behavior in large part. Now, you're asking, are his players on Twitter? Well, no, they're not supposed to be. And maybe they are and maybe they're not. But what I do know is it's typically Mex Carey or Matt Larson that surveys social media and will bring to his attention things that are said. And again, you know, as somebody that does this podcast, yours truly, with you, you know, I'm going to be critical. I try to keep it fair, honest, accurate, not personal, not in any way, shape, manner, form. I love Xavier Tillman. I followed him and covered him when I was in Grand Rapids when he played both at Forest Hills Central and Grand Rapids Christian. And this is a very good young man who I sing the praises of all the time. He has a bad game. You know, I feel I owe it to people that follow this podcast, follow me on Twitter, for an honest assessment of a performance. And if it's bad, it's bad. If it's good, it's good. And, you know, I just want to come down on the side of accuracy and analyze what is happening, why it's happening, and what it means going forward. And I think his performance at Wisconsin, for his, he would tell you, he was not happy with it. It's not that you're piling on and you feel like this guy needs to hear it from you. Now, maybe there are fans like that, and those are dopes. But to me, you got to tune that out. This is a team that has far bigger problems, Tom, right now, than social media. They can't win games. They just lost one on their home court to Penn State. They're in a slugfest and a mud slog and a fight for the conference title, one that we thought just maybe a week ago they were going to cruise to and that they were shifting into overdrive. I don't know why Tom Izzo would take this kind of sideshow carnival of Twitter and make it a central issue. I don't know that that's a good move by him.
Well, I don't know how abrasive or graphic. We don't know what this particular tweet or tweets cited. I do know that. I mean, listen, if you're playing high profile college basketball, college football. I mean, this goes with a territory that you're going to be critiqued. I mean, and I like John Teske. Okay, I'll make and we'll talk about this briefly here about Michigan. He has digressed this past year from this year from last year. Okay, that is a legitimate statement. Is he out there trying? Hell yes. Is he a great kid? Oh, he's an awesome kid. I enjoyed talking to him. But he has digressed, and he's given up big points. Is that not professional for me, or not etiquette friendly for me to say that? I say that's fine for you to say that. But I guess when you get into some repulsive type social media, which I referred to early on a second ago about the Michigan State football team and what Izzo might be referring to, then that's a whole nother animal.
Yeah, I'm with you there, Tom, and I have no time or use for people like that. Their opinions don't matter to me, and this is something I just told a friend of mine. She was getting accosted on Twitter. Old tweets are being brought up. She's all scared about what it might mean to her reputation. So with that, I say, you know, those who matter don't mind, and those who mind don't matter. That is a saying I come back to time and again. I care what you think about me, Tom. I really do.
Right. I do too. I'm with you right there. Yeah, baby.
I mean, I care. It matters to me what Tom Izzo thinks, and I take his opinion very seriously. He's a Hall of Fame coach, and there are people out there whose opinions matter to me. And if they criticize me, say, Ryan, you know, you might have went too far there. I think you crossed the line. I think you're too harsh or you're too tough. I'll listen to that. But if it's coming from, you know, the bleachers, from some lunatic who I don't even know, who doesn't even use their real name or face on Twitter, what do I care? Why would I get worked up about that? Why would I let that person affect my day and how I feel? I'm not going to let them do that.
No, I agree totally. Yeah, and real briefly, back on that Michigan State team, I am all too savvy on this Penn State team. I saw them up close and personal beat Michigan a couple weeks ago, and they beat them by 9 points, and it was – they beat them actually – it was misleading. They controlled that game from start to finish. This is a really, really good basketball team of Pat Chambers, so that's not a bad loss. But will I do say, when I look at Michigan State optically, and I had to do a little research after the game because I was coming home from Ann Arbor and just caught the last few minutes with Will Tiemann and Matt Stegega, but the fact is you have optically – with Cassius Winston, you know, he shot 21 times. And when you look at the box score, it substantiates it. There's a lot of just guys. The other four guys are looking at Cassius to do his magic. And it seems to me, optically, that's not a good look for them and their offensive pattern.
Yeah, I call it Cassius and his band of merry men when they fall into that trap that you just outlined. And that was the case, I think, a lot in this game. Now, Penn State had a lot to do with that. I'll say this front and center. For Penn State to come into Breslin and win that game the way that they did when Michigan State had come back and taken a lead and it looked like the momentum was gone for good and they buckled down and they got some tough rebounds and they made some big shots. I mean, this said a lot, in my opinion, about the Nittany Lions and how good they are. They've won 5 in a row. They are 7-4 in conference now, 17-5 overall. I agree with you wholeheartedly, Tom. They are 4-1 against the AP and USA Today top 25. Here's Pat Chambers, head coach Penn State, his thoughts after this 75-70 victory for the Nittany Lions.
Okay, coach, as this one sinks in, I've got to ask, I saw you not watching a couple of those free throws. I know how much these wins mean to you. How do you describe this type of feeling for you personally?
I'm incredibly happy for my team, my staff, and my program. We've got a long way to go here, but man, they competed, and that's all I wanted to do. On the road, just compete, give us a chance with 4 minutes to go. And they just, great huddles, great bench, really connected, really trusted each other, especially when they took the lead a couple times. We're on the seesaw. That's what good teams do on the road.
And that's a good point. How do these tight games on the road help prepare you for what's to come?
I mean, playing in a one-possession game in Breslin is everything, right? This is the pinnacle with the great program that Izzo has and everything he does year in and year out. So be able to come here, made timely three throws. Yeah, we missed a couple before that. That's why I was like, you know what? I'm not watching anymore. I just said routine, shoot with confidence. But this is going to get us stronger. This is going to get us better. Got to put our walls up, though. Social media, all the outside noise, all the distractions. You got to put our walls up.
All right, I won't bother you guys, Coach. But that makes 3 straight conference road wins. How are you all defining now where you're at as a program?
We're climbing. That's for sure. We're climbing. Look, it's about defending and rebounding. I thought for the most part we took care of the ball. We had a couple turnovers here in the second half. But for the most part, you got to take care of the ball. You got to play great defense. You got to rebound the ball. I can't wait to see the stat sheet because I thought we did a really good job of defensively rebounding the ball against one of the best teams in the country.
Coach, congratulations. I promise I won't tweet at you or your players congratulating you.
Thank you.
So next up for Michigan State, Michigan, High Noon Showdown. That's Saturday, this Saturday, televised on Fox. And all of a sudden, you throw this ball up and you don't know what's going to happen. Michigan, for their part, a devastating loss on their home court. A game that they really thought they could win, and I think they needed to win. Sure, they can steal another one somewhere else, but this was one of those, as Tom and I mapped out the rest of the season, that I figured would be in the win column for Michigan. They fall 61-58. There was a controversial call at the end of this one. No two ways about it. I was shaking my head when it happened. It was a foul and then a counter foul, flagrant called on Xavier Simpson pulling a guy down. Here were Juwan Howard's thoughts on that after the game.
What did you see on the flagrant foul there at the end?
I didn't see it. And I tried to ask for explanation. I tried to look for it. It was being shown on the monitor, a replay right there near our bench. So I started to look at it when I was talking to the referee. And then as I was looking, he was about to show it for the rewind, and he told the guy to shut it off immediately. So I was like, wow, you know, let me see what happened. And he was explaining it to me, and I'm like, I couldn't believe it. How it explained, because I'm sure one of you want to know, or all of you want to know, it was explained like Xavier went up for a layup, and as he was coming down, he grabbed his jersey and ripped it. So I was like, okay, well, grabbed his jersey and ripped it. I'm like, he said, yeah, look at his jersey, it's ripped. So I'm looking, and then I said, well, now, former basketball player myself, I'm looking, I'm like, well, if he's going up, and this is how I'm thinking, and I asked him, I said, if he's going up and he's falling, did he grab him to brace his fall? And he said, yes. I said, well, I guess that means that, you know, he needed some help. He did not want to absorb the contact or the momentum of hitting the floor. And that was it. So at the end of the day, we had to respect their call that was made. Unfortunately, I didn't see it.
Did Xavier say anything to you?
No, he did not. We did not speak about it at all. So I'll go back and I'll watch film tonight. I'm sure I'm going to replay it over and over. It's a tough one to swallow, I swear. This, like all the losses, but you know, this one hurts a lot. It was a very hard-fought game. Both teams competed extremely hard. Kind of remind me of the old-school Big Ten, physical, you know, sludge matches, ugly shots not being made. People driving to the basket, getting fouled, no calls. I mean, that's a part of the Big Ten.
15 points, 7 rebounds, 5 assists. Solid game for Xavier Simpson in this one. But only one other double-digit scorer, and it's not who you might imagine or guess. It was Austin Davis with 11 points in 14 minutes. The Ohio State Buckeyes get a tremendous game out of Caleb Wesson. Another big game from a big player. I'm talking about a big, like a front court player. 23 points, 12 rebounds in this one as Michigan falls on their home court to the hated Buckeyes, 61-58. Tom, your analysis of this one and what it means for the Wolverines.
Oh, a highly painful, highly damaging loss for the Wolverines. I mean, the Chrysler was rocking last night. It was a stripe out. You had maize and blue every other section with T-shirts. It was a perfect storm to have a good win, and Michigan had 7 points at the 11-minute mark of the first half. They are so frustrating to watch offensively. And I'm going to tell you why, because they get good looks. I mean, they rotate the ball. They rebounded very well, and in the semi break they got good looks, but they don't have any shooters on this team. And the name of the game is to put the ball in the hoop. And yeah, 10 of 31 from 3-point land, but when you have Franz Wagner, I mean, he had 8 3-point attempts, and of those 8 attempts, most of them he had a lot of separation from the opposition. He's just not knocking them down. Duncan Robinson's not walking down the tunnel. You know, Jordan Poole's not there anymore. They need a shooter, and this is where it's becoming glaringly. The departure of Isaiah Livers is really hurting this team. It's one step forward, a couple steps back, and I am not feeling it for Saturday. I mean, as much as I was excited about that they won that game at MSG, which I feel is a really good Rutgers team that went toe-to-toe with Maryland last night, mm-hmm. and could have won that game, this is just not the year. And the reason it's not the year is because, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, John Teske has just digressed. Anytime you get a high caliber or above average pivot man going against you, we know it. You know, we know what's going to happen. And obviously, with Caleb Wesson last night, I mean, the guy had 15 points in the first half, mm-hmm. ended up with 23 points and 12 boards. And my guy, without Austin Davis, I hate to see where this team would be right now, Brian.
Yeah, you combine three players that they need contributions from, 6 for 31. 6 for 31 when you combine Teske,
Wagner, and Eli Brooks. Brooks was 3 of 12, not a big factor in this game. Wagner, the guy looks like he could be a sharpshooter from the outside, but he just hasn't found that groove. He was just 2 of 12 in the 61-58 defeat. He did hold down 14 rebounds. Teske himself, I mean, when he has 3 and the guy he's guarding, Wesson, has 23 and Teske's 1 for 7, you're not going to win. They only hit a third of their shots, Michigan, 20 for 60, 33%, and it wasn't good enough. They fall to 13-9 overall, 4-7 now in conference play. And, you know, must win, you can throw that around. It's a cliche term, but this is an important game for both teams, I think. Michigan, Michigan State coming in on a down note to a rivalry game at Chrysler Center. It would be an enormous victory for Michigan. For Michigan State, it would get them back on track after 2 straight losses, perhaps, to get in the middle of the Big Ten race where they're a half game back now behind Maryland and Illinois. So, Tom, final take here, just looking ahead to the game on Saturday. You'll be there in Ann Arbor, high noon on Fox. What is it going to take? What are you looking for in this contest for the Wolverines against the Spartans?
Well, Michigan is just going to have to, uncharacteristically shoot well. That's just the way it's going to be for this year. I can't believe I'm saying that because the Beeline teams are such great shooting teams from the perimeter. I don't know, man, that could happen. I mean, there's definitely good enough looks, and I think they're good enough to beat Michigan State. But what concerns me is it's bad enough playing Michigan State coming off a loss, but it's really difficult for playing Michigan State coming off back-to-back losses. So I think Michigan State is going to, you know, take care of the basketball much better than they did against Penn State and Wisconsin. And I hope to hell I'm wrong, but I think Michigan will play them tough. But I see Michigan State, you know, pulling this thing out with a 4-6 point win. Here we go again, and that would be what are we talking about? 5 straight losses after Michigan beat them three in a row, 5 straight losses, and I'm already looking forward to next year. Is that sad to say? But I am looking forward to next year, and I'm all into Juwan. I'm totally into Juwan. I'm bought into Juwan Howard and where this program is going. But this season is without Livers. It's just not pulling together. And it's the Big Ten's too tough. Any other year it might have worked. Not this year.
Yeah, tremendous teams in the Big Ten. I don't ever remember it being this deep, this loaded with very good teams in Penn State.
Tremendous teams with the shittiest officiating crews I've ever seen in my life. Both in East Lansing and Ann Arbor were exhibit A and B on that.
Yeah, last night, not great. And Jay Billis made a comment about that in the television broadcast. Just a lot of fouls that weren't called, and that went both ways. So Michigan will have to find a way. As Tom mentioned, shooting will be key for them. If they can hit big shots, get hot, that'll keep them in the game against Michigan State. But let's face it, both these teams are sputtering right now. Wolverines 3-6 in their last 9 games. Spartans 3-4 in their last 7. Something's got to give. Noon start Fox. Our own Blue Billy Tom Crawford will be there in attendance to get all the post-game sound. We'll have a recap of that either Saturday night or Sunday morning, depending on when Tom gets back and when we can record. And then we'll look at the stretch run for both teams here on the Great Lakes Divide. That'll do it for us from here for now. For Blue Billy Tom Crawford, I'm Ryan Schuling. Heather Ferrari and the Record Lounge, our proud sponsor, sending you out the sounds that you're hearing right now. And again, we appreciate their support. We invite you to support them. They're located on Washington South from 496 and downtown Lansing on the east side of the street. There's free parking. Walk on in, take that journey back through time, and take a look ahead. They have new music coming in each and every Friday. That's the Record Lounge in Reotown. Enjoy Michigan, Michigan State this Saturday, everyone. We'll talk about it on the other side.
I've been caught stealing once when I was fine. I ain't just stealing.